experimental collaboration, and I'm very eager to hear about the news there. So thank you.
So thank you, and I really want to thank the organizers for having me here, and those of you who are still here, I appreciate it. And so yeah, today I'm going to talk about some recent work that we have been doing on work.
It doesn't work.
It doesn't
Okay, so this is going to be some work that we do together with the group of Ron Polman in Israel. So the plan for the talk, I think, is going to be relatively short. I will give a very brief introduction, which is going to be brief, especially after Chris Jasinski explained most of what I need to say about quantum work and quantum fluctuations. And Jasinski identity, he's the only person that calls it the work relations, so for the rest of us, it's Jasinski identity. And I will focus on this issue of how to measure work in a way which is different than the usual one by doing these two-time measurements. And I will introduce this concept of the quantum work meter, and then I will show you how to build the quantum work meter on a real experiment that we did using an atom chip that manipulates a cloud of cold rubidium atoms. And I think it's the first experiment where there is a sort of an efficient sampling of the work probability distribution direct. And we verified Jasinski identities and we played several games that we'll show you. So the idea is, the references. So all the story related to this new way of measuring work at a single time, quotations, was presented 2.5 years ago on this paper that was published together with my colleague, Augusto Roncaglia, a former student, and our student, Federico Cerisola. It was late in 2014. And what I'm going to talk about, just by mere coincidence, appeared today in Nature Science. So before I gave a talk last week, this was hiding, so there was no mention to Nature Science here. It was just the archive because I was not supposed to say anything. But today, I'm happy, I can say. And this is with Ron Folman, that is someone here, and his group, Yair Margalit and Shemi Makhlouf, and together with Federico Cirisola and Augusto Rocaglia from Buenos Aires. So, very briefly, we have been hearing what work is, in, so I'm going to be focusing for most of the talk, but I will refer also, I will be talking about closed system, so unitary evolution, but I will also mention some issues related to what happens with the Jasinski identity when you have noise, basically, unital maps. And we know that there is this idea of defining work as the difference between the results of two energy measurements at two times. Then we have a random variable that is distributed with this probability distribution. This is very well known. Pn is the probability to get energy En, so these are the energy eigenstates, phi n. For the initial Hamiltonian, so you drive the system from an initial Hamiltonian to a final Hamiltonian, and in between you drive with a unitary operator U. So this is the probability to get the first result, and this is the transition probability from the initial eigenstate to the final eigenstate. So the question is there another way to measure the energy? It doesn't seem to be completely obvious because as it was pointed out in this very similar paper about with the title "Work is not an observable" by Eric and co-workers.
Eric, we should say
Thank you, co-workers.
Well, for to me, it's, you are my friend, so. Yeah, yeah, I know. Hangi and co-workers. Another way, work is not an observable. A very easy way to see it is that you will never be able to measure work by measuring a standard observable emission operator. The idea is very simple, that the number of values that work can take is much larger than the dimension of the Hilbert space, because if you have finite dimension D, you have D values here, D values there, then you have D squared, there is no room. There will never be a emission operator that you could measure in order to measure work. Well, this is the motivation. Why do you want to measure work? Well, it satisfies these beautiful fluctuation relations. This is Yersin's scale entity, which I will not derive, and that connects very beautifully non-equilibrium concepts with equilibrium concepts. In what sense, and this I want to emphasize, the work probability distribution is strongly dependent on non-equilibrium properties. So this is something that depends on how you drive the system from here to there. And the dependence is hidden here in the transition probability. This depends on the unitary U that goes in between. So this is non-equilibrium, but somehow the exponential work relates directly to equilibrium properties. This is very nice. Also, for the case, as Chris was pointing out, if you have a non-unitary evolution with a completely positive map, lambda, that takes you from here to there, now you have non-unitarity, Yersin's K identity is preserved if the map preserves the identity. It's like a game of words, but it's true. It's very easy to see that if the map preserves the identity, so it's unital, then you get the identity, Yersin's K identity, in the same way. And this was discussed before. So we want to measure work and verify this in a quantum system. The question is there an alternative strategy to measure work at a single time, for example? I think that for many years, I think the answer would have been no for before our work, I think, I don't know. But we proved that it is possible. So you can do it. And the way to do it is very simple. So this is the existence proof of that there should be a way to do it. And the reason is very simple, because we accepted that work probability distribution is this one. By measuring work at the single time, I want just a method that would give me the outcome W, which sampled with the probability P of W, by making a projective measurement at just one time. So somehow the wave function collapses at the end. There is no collapse in between. Okay? I want to, this will be my work measurement strategy. So the existence of such a method, you can prove it just by looking, but by noticing that this probability distribution, you can get it as the trace of the initial state times some operator A of W, one for each W, and that these operators are positive and they form a decomposition of the identity. So this tells you that work measurement is nothing but a generalized quantum measurement. This defines what is known as a POVM, positive operator value measurement. And this is the most general type of measurement you can do in a quantum system. So there is a method to measure if you are able to implement this POVM. And moreover, you look at Asher Peres' book, this such beautiful book that was mentioned today, and there is a theorem, Neumark's theorem, that tells you that any POVM, any generalized quantum measurement, can be realized in this way. So, this doesn't work. Yeah, okay. Can be realized in this way. So, any POVM can be realized by a standard measurement on a system which is enlarged. So you have to bring together your system with an ancilla, do something to both of them jointly, so there is some interaction, and then by looking at the state of the ancilla, you will get the outcome W with sorted out with the probability P of W, and then you will prepare the system in some state, which is conditioned on the value of work. So this is existence proof. Is a PO, the work measurement is a POVM, POBM can be realized in this way. That's it. So the only remaining question is how to, what to put in here, this black box that ended up being white here. So the question is, what is it in the black box? So you can look at our paper, and first we showed that you can break this white box or black box here into pieces. All over, this is going to be the system. So it's this is like a quantum circuit description of the evolution of this combined system plus ancilla. We can break the white box in first an entangling operation, followed by a stage of the driving, the evolution of the system, followed by another entangling operation, and then you look at the state of the ancilla. Of course, I'm replacing, in this way, what you are getting here, so this is completely unitary. No? Mm-hmm. Coherence is preserved. Well, I mean, there is an entangling and so on. When you look, you do a projective measurement, but you do this at the end. And before you do it, there is sort of a coherent record of work stored in this register. This is the general strategy, but to communicate with something, I have to tell you what is in the now in the blue box and in the yellow box, because I replaced the black box by boxes of two different colors. And this is also in the paper, and it's very easy to show that a way to do it is not unique, but because you can implement the POBM in more than one way, but a way to do it is if the state of the system for some reason here appears sigma and not rho, and we prepare the ancilla, I will assume for the sake of simplicity that the ancilla will be a continuous variable system, like the pointer of an apparatus, which will be prepared initially in some arbitrary pure state. And the entangling operations, the two entangling operations, should be of this form. So they should be described by some unitary, and they are, if P is the generator of translations in the pointer of the apparatus, the momentum of the apparatus, the interaction between these two guys must be of the type that it will induce a translation of the apparatus conditioned by the energy, by the Hamiltonian of the system. So you create a record of the energy of the system in the apparatus, and then in the last one, you do the same thing, but with H tilde and with the opposite sign in order to get the record of the difference between the two energies. And very simply, you have to evolve here. So this is the stage where you apply the driving into the system. And it's very simple to realize that if you finally make a measurement of the coordinate conjugated to P here at the end, the probability to obtain, so this is the quantum state of the combined system, which has the unitary evolution of the whole thing. From here you compute the probability to get a certain result, X, and it's very simple to realize that what you get is a coarse-grained version of the true work probability distribution. So P of W is the work probability distribution I was showing you before. The probability of having a certain x is not equal to P of W, but it's the convolution between P of W and some window function, which is determined by the initial state of the system. So if you prepare a narrow initial state of your apparatus, then you will be able to distinguish the different outcomes of work. Okay? So this is a method to measure work or to sample the work probability distribution. And we called this actually, not we, but Peter Hange called it the quantum world meter in a paper where he reviewed different methods of measuring work. Just as an aside, I just want to emphasize that this is that the result I just told you, it's exact. So it works if the initial state of the system has no coherence, so if it is diagonal in the energy basis, then you have this identity, but if it also works if if you have initial coherences, so if this, if the initial state of the apparatus resembles a pure state, which has thermal populations but also has coherences, but the entangling interactions are strong enough so that the different weight packets that are associated with the different values of work do not overlap. Because the final distribution of the outcome X will be like sequence of peaks, if the peaks are separated far enough, so in some sense, if these interactions are strong, then the sampling of the work measurement is, the final distribution is the coarse-grained version of the work probability distribution that we defined previously, which is the one we wanted to sample. Otherwise, there are interference effects. So in the paper, in the work, in the experiment that I'm going to describe, this is plays some role because we did not prepare really a thermal state initially, but we prepared a state which has some coherences, but it's it has some populations. The energy levels are populated, can associate it with a certain temperature, but the initial coherences do not play a role because of these weight packets are well separated between each other.
What happens to the system after you do the measurement on the work? Does it, because of the entanglement, does it affect the system? Or
it gets
increase its entropy? Or?
Yeah, so it collapses and is prepared into a state that depends on the value of work that you measure. So you get, for every W that you measure, you prepare a system. In our experiments, I will you will see what happens. This is drawn. But okay, so two remarks about general issues of this scheme. One of them is that a nice way to think of this quantum work meter is in terms of a sort of quantum simulator. In what sense? So what I will give you is a way to implement this this circuit, a physical substrate where you can do these operations. And where you can sort of implement these blue boxes and implement this unitary U and utility that you need to be the first and the second entangling interaction, and you can also implement different driving schemes. This will depend on what is the physical substrate that you are using. But if the physical substrate that you are using enables you to engineer this entangling operation so that different H's appear here and H tilde, you will have a machine that will satisfy sort of a customer that comes to your lab and tells you, please sample the work probability distribution with this initial Hamiltonian, that final Hamiltonian, and this intermediate time. So our machine will be able to do that. Okay? Somehow, this initial Hamiltonian and the final Hamiltonian need not to be the real generators of temporal evolution. They are just, this is a machine which is aimed at sampling work probability distributions. It can be viewed in that way.
Pablo?
Yes?
Yes?
So do you assume that in the state?
Did I assume what?
Do you assume that you know the initial state?
No. The initial state here?
Yeah, you don't know the initial state, right?
In the experiment?
Yes.
I didn't tell you about the experiment yet, but
no,
we prepared an initial state. We prepared an initial state with a certain, which was thermally populated with a temperature that we put from the outside. So we said, okay, let's prepare an initial state with this temperature and another one with that other temperature and so on. So we have control over the initial state, yes.
But for the scheme, it is not necessary.
Is it necessary for the scheme to
no,
know
it,
the initial state?
So it is necessary for the scheme to work, to have you, for you to work exactly, for you to have the promise that you are starting with a thermal initial
state.
That is
a classical state.
That is a classic. So if you have coherences, and you have strong interactions, it will also work.
only like accuracy on error. I'm not exactly what, because we've proved that it's impossible to have.
Right. It's up to some error. Yeah. So you cannot do it exactly. Yes. But the errors will be, well, I will show you. These are sort of the way packets are well separated is as small as you want it to be. Okay. And then there is another way to look at this, which I'm going to be very briefly just mention it. Maybe I just completely skip it. But you can view this circuit somehow. Suppose that you have a quantum computer and you make these wires out of registers. So you have n qubits here, n qubits there, and you can view this circuit as an efficient algorithm. The algorithm is efficient provided that you can implement these unitaries efficiently and this driving efficiently. An efficient way of sampling the world probability distribution with the quantum computer, which is very much, very similar to the so-called phase estimation algorithm. So it's essentially, you're using the phase estimation algorithm, which is the core of many. Well, the most important quantum algorithms, such as Shor's, which was invented by Kitaev, and somehow you're using, sort of, you're putting the information about the work in the face of this register, and then you're looking at the things. So, how do we build a quantum work meter? We used an atom, so this is in this paper. We used an atom chip, which was already existing in Ron Forman lab in Ben Gurion University in Israel. This is the picture of the chip. I will tell you very briefly what basically this is. But the idea is the following. So the quantum circuit that I was showing you before, we realized it physically in the following way. The system is going to be the internal states of the rubidium atoms. They are going to, I will be more specific in the next slide, but they are going to be hyperfine Zeeman split sublevels. We are going to work with the dimension 2, but we are working also in extending this to d equal 3. And the ancilla, the auxiliary system, is going to be the motion and degrees of freedom of the atom. So they are going to be it's going to be written in the same system. So that's why we cannot. As we are going to measure the position of the atom, make an image, this will destroy the initial state of the auxiliary. The final state of the auxiliary guy will disappear. But in principle, it can exist. And we will use the chip in order to do all the operations that we need, and which are the entangling interactions and the driving operations, and then the image. These little boxes that appear here, we have modified slightly the presentation I gave you, but this is not worth discussing. Basically because in the real game, while the atom is evolving, there is some free Hamiltonian of the motion and things change, so we have to take that into account. To have an idea, this all the actions, so the chip is on the surface, and all the action takes place in the vertical direction. Why do the atoms are falling? So there is a free fall. That's why it says free fall here. So what can we do with the chip? So first, our system is a two-level system, with very good approximation, and the levels are hyperfine sublevels. We work in the subspace with f equal to 2. This principal number f equal to 2, and the m can be the magnetic number can be 2, 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2, but we apply, Ron and his postdocs and students, so the chip, there is a magnetic field, static magnetic field, homogeneous, and a bias field that induces a splitting of these levels. The splitting between the m equal 2 and m equal 1 is in the 25 megahertz. And due to the nonlinear Zeeman split so the split between 1 and 0 is different, so we can address separately these two levels and these two levels. We make sure that only the 2 and 1 levels are explored in the experiment. Okay? So the atom is initially loaded from a BEC in the M equal 2 level, is magnetically trapped, and then we only apply radio frequency pulses that make it oscillate between 2 and 1, and it never goes away from this subspace. So the toolbox that we use from the atomic chip is first precisely that. We apply radio frequency pulses that induce rabi oscillations between these two levels, the level 2 and the level 1. So we can create arbitrary superpositions between 2 and 1 by applying conveniently chosen radio frequency pulses. This is going to be used in order to drive the system, to inject work on your system. And the other thing that we can do is to apply, the peculiarity of the chip that induced us to contact Ron and suggest the experiment, that the chip, so they have three wires in the chip where they make three currents, two in one direction on the sides and the other one opposite, in order to create a quadrupolar magnetic field that you can turn on and off. In this way, you can induce magnetic gradient pulses. Okay, so you can turn on and off this field, and you can, to a very good approximation. So this is the chip, and the atoms will be falling in this direction, and there is a relatively large region, not too large, but large enough, where the magnetic field is linear with the direction, with the vertical direction, and while the atoms is exploring this region, you can turn on and off the magnetic field, and the atom will suffer gradient pulses. When there is a gradient pulse, what happens? So the Hamiltonian of the atom then is dominated by this strong magnetic field, and there is just magnetic interaction, but the magnetic field is proportional to the position, Z, and then the atom, the Hamiltonian, essentially is proportional to the position of the atom here, up to this constant. There is Bohr magnetron, Lambda factor, and the magnetic, the intensity of the magnetic gradient, and is proportional to the internal magnetic moment of the atom. So you have, if this the state is 1, is M equal to 1, you have eigenvalue 1, and eigenvalue 2 if the state is M equal to 2. So what happens with the magnetic gradient is that precisely implements the type of interaction that you need for the entangling interaction in order to build the quantum work meter, because the unitary evolution operator that is associated with this Hamiltonian is basically the exponential of minus I, this h times the duration, and precisely you see that it has a z here, and it has something that we can call Hamiltonian h, which is delta p, this basically what this U does is it induces a kick in momentum, which is conditioned on the internal state of the atom. So it's Stern-Gerlach. So if the atom is in M equal to 1, it will change the velocity in some amount. If it is in M equal to 2, it will change the velocity in twice this amount. In the previous description, I was saying, in order to build a quantum work meter, you need something with P here. But we, having Z is the same, because the only thing that tells you is that what you have to measure is the conjugate variable to Z, which is the momentum. So it's the description, theoretical description is equivalent. So with this with these ingredients, we built this quantum circuit. And there is just a nice feature of this scheme, which is the fact that this is a universal quantum work meter for a two-level system, basically. In what sense it's universal? It is universal in the sense that the initial and the final Hamiltonians, which are basically determined by what is the entangling interaction here and there, so what is the magnetic gradient pulse that you implement, how strong it is, and what is the magnetic gradient pulse that you implement at the end. These Hamiltonians can be arbitrary. So the only thing that matters for work, basically, is the level splitting between the two Hamiltonians, because then there is a constant that you can change. It will only change the absolute value of work, but it will not change the work probability distribution. So if you add a constant to this Hamiltonian, some a term proportional to the identity, nothing changes. So only the level splitting, E and E tilde, are what define basically H and H tilde. And of course, the basis in which both are diagonal. The first one you can choose arbitrarily, and the second you can also choose arbitrarily by applying appropriately the change of basis before the magnetic gradient. So we have all the ingredients in order to have this idea of, if you come to me and say, sample the work probability distribution with this initial Hamiltonian, that final Hamiltonian, and this intermediate driving, this will do it for D equal 2 only. What we have to play with is this experimental, the thing that we control in the lab is the ratio between the final and the initial level split of the Hamiltonians that we are sampling, the work distribution. And this is basically the ratio between the final and the initial level splitting is the ratio between the strength of the gradient pulse, the final, and the duration of the pulse, divided by the same thing at the initial time. So this is a universal machine. For the case of T equal 3, it's not so easy. But we are, so this, maybe I say something at the end. So these are, let me show you some of the results. And as I said, the experiment is such that the chip is located here, and the atoms are prepared about 100 micrometers away from the surface of the field. They are loaded from a BEC, and then they are the trap is open and they fall. And while they fall, you do things. What you do is first you prepare an initial state, which has some initial, so it's a superposition between 1 and 2, and from the populations of this initial superposition, you can define the temperature, which is related to the probability of being in 1 divided by the probability of being in 2. It's equal to the log of some. So that's the temperature. And as I told you, to a good approximation, the coefficients will not matter. So you prepare the initial state, and we dial the temperature. Then we let the atoms fall. We implement the first magnetic gradient. Then we drive the system, and then the second magnetic gradient. And then, after some time, we do imaging. Okay, the magnetic gradients, what they will do is they will split, coherently split, a la Stern-Gerlach, the cloud, because they will kick the atoms with some velocity if m is equal to 1, and another velocity if m is equal to 2, and this will amplify, and the wave packets will separate, and then they will be split again, so you will end up with an image that is something like this. So you get 4 clouds. From the position of the clouds, you can infer the velocity kick that the atoms received, and therefore you can infer what is the work. And from the number of atoms that you count in each cloud, you infer the probability of having this value of work. So this is an experiment which has this nice feature of being a direct sampling of the work probability distribution in a single shot, because you are, of course, this is so because you are using many atoms at once. So you get a picture, and this is the picture of the work probability distribution, counting the number of atoms.
So are we?
Yes.
Are we just saying, like, are we just looking for the number of atoms in each cloud, or also for the structure of each cloud? Because the structure is always changing, so it seems like the velocity distribution inside of each spin seems to be changing. Do we care about this, or this is just an artificial fact of external perfections?
This is so not the structure in each cloud. We look at the total number of atoms in each. Remember that what we have, the final. So we measure the position here, and what I told you from the previous discussion is that the probability of having different positions is a coarse-grained version of the work probability distribution with a window function which determines this the shape of the cloud, which depends on the initial state. And this is distorted a bit because of experimental errors. So we don't pay that much attention. So we count the number of atoms in each cloud. We are sure that the clouds are well separated, that we don't see interference effects, and so on.
So this is another way of putting the results. So we get this image, the four clouds, and we from the position we infer the value of work, and then we take into account that this is a coarse grain version, so we add up all the atoms that are here and we get the probability. So we get directly the histogram, that is the probability of having the different work values. Okay? And we do this for many realizations of the driving. This is this picture is for one driving field, one specific driving field. And as I told you, the probability of having a certain value of work depends on you, the way you drive the system. So you drive it one way, and you will get this probability distribution. You drive another way, and the peaks will change, and these buildings will be taller and shorter depending on the position. So you get different histograms. Okay? And then, because in the experiment, we keep H and H tilde fixed, just to make it simpler. So the positions of the peak remain fixed because the values of the work are fixed then, and we only change the height of the peaks by changing the driving. Okay? And just this is the result, the ratio between the final and the initial energy split. So it means so this number was set in the experiment, we changed it, but the figures that I'm showing are for 0.57. It means that what I'm showing you are probability sampling of the work probability distribution when you take a two-level system from an initial Hamiltonian into a final Hamiltonian that has a level split, which is 57% of the original one, okay, and is driven in a certain way. So this is the interpretation of this plot. So let's see what happens if we compare the result of several experiments where several runs of the same experiment where we drive with different driving fields. So for each driving field, we get these four probabilities just by looking at the picture, which is in a single shot, we get the probability distribution. And we plot it, so I have very bad vision, so I cannot even see the axis, so I will kill my student. The plot, now I can see this and this. So it's a 3D plot, because really you measure only three independent probabilities because the fourth one is fixed by normalization. They all add up to one. So we have only three independent numbers that we get from each run of the experiment. And we get here a plot, even I can see it, a dot. So this is the result of the previous experiment. Four is for one initial state. And in a minute I will show you for three different initial states with three different temperatures. And then we do it again, and we get another point somewhere else. And we do it again, and we get points and points and points, and you see what happens? They line up. Okay? So they form a line up to some errors, of course. We change the initial state, and we get what? Another line. So the first one moved because I was not, I'm not a PowerPoint
perfectionist. And then we change the temperature, and again, well, everything moves, but not. So it's obvious we are getting a line in this space of probabilities for each initial temperature. So it means that you drive the system in many ways, and sort of the different probability distributions line up along a line. Why is that the case? Because of Yarzynski identity. We call these lines the so-called Yarzynski manifold, because you can look at this identity as a linear constraint between the probability vector. So this just tells you that if you take the three probabilities, so here we are adding up four
probabilities, but one is in, is dependent, is only three are independent. So you can view this as a constraint in the probability space. These are fixed numbers because they are fixed by the initial temperature and the work, which is fixed. And in the right-hand side, you have the equilibrium property that you are mentioning, which is also fixed. So this Yersinski manifold, it's a bit surprising that they are lines and not a plane, because you have 3D vectors and one constraint. It means that they should lie on a plane, D equal 2. But in the paper, you can see, you can see the demonstration that the dimensionality of this Yersinski manifold is D minus 1 to the power 2, which is which means that there are further constraints that constrain the so there are hidden relations between these probability distributions, which are obvious if you look at the initial slide that I showed, how you define the probability distribution. The number of degrees of freedom, once you fix the initial temperature, is nothing but the numbers of the number of independent transition probabilities that you can have. And this is d minus 1 to the power 2, which in the case of d equal 2 gives you 1. So it's a line. So these three lines are the Yersinski manifold for the three temperatures. So the fact that you get all these unitary processes lining up is a verification of the Yersinski identity. We also can do something else. We can do, as Chris was pointing out, they did this experiment implemented, kind of testing the validity of Yersinski identity. He was calling it work relation, because he's a modest guy, for process with noise, unital. So what I can do is, again, do it, but suppose that I take the average work probability, average probability vector for the three temperatures. So there is a black dot here, here, and here. So this is supposed to be the average probability vector between all these realizations of unitary processes, and the same for the red, and the same for the green. It's very easy to realize that the average probability vector is nothing but, so it's taking 1 over the number of realizations of unitary that you have, and take the vector probability vector that you get for certain, for the, for that unitary, and you sum over all the unitaries that you are implementing. It's very easy that to see that this vector is nothing but the vector that you would get for the process where you evolve the density matrix by this channel lambda, which is just nothing but the convex combination of the unitaries that you are applying. So this is, these three black dots correspond to the three black three probability distributions that you would get for this initial state and unital evolution in that sense. Okay? So the test of Yersinski identity I showed, and we can use Yersinski identity to compute free energy differences, which is nothing. So you can do it by, so we have these lines, and we have to characterize what are the parameters that define the lines, and in this way you basically what you're doing is you're estimating the free energy. Or you can do it in this way again. So we can plot the free energy for the initial temperature. Now here is this plot is all the realizations of all the different experiments. The points are different unitaries, which are ordered according the duration of the pulse. It's an arbitrary way of doing it. You can change the phase, you can change the intensity, but okay, here we chose just one parameter to make this plot. And you see that when you compute from Yersinski identity, you just we measure the probabilities. We know what these numbers are, we just compute the sum and we get the exponential, we take the log and change the sign. I think that this is for the beta delta F, I think. So we get that for one temperature we get this, for another temperature we get that, for a third temperature we get this. I'm being honest, and there are some errors, which are experimental errors. I blame the experimentalists. They are, we understand them, and we can correct them, but we were, so the experiment was
the laser is broken and so on. So we decided not to wait. And so these errors, so the main source of errors is on the one hand the uncertainty in the estimation of the initial temperature, because this requires an independent experiment that has its own errors, and also the fact that for this the green case, which is sort of a very low temperature, when one of the populations is very small, then some of the clouds have very small number of atoms, so the error in the estimation of the number of atoms is the relative error is bigger, so it's a problem. But in any case, we think that the experimental results agree pretty much with theory, and that Chris should be happy, I think. And there is another way to show you the results. The results for the three temperatures that I showed, the better, the intermediate, and the worst, so this was the blue, red, and green. So the estimated value of beta delta F, this is the measured value of beta delta F. This is not for the previous case, no? For the previous case, I was showing this plot, which was basically showing what happens for each realization of the experiment. Now I'm going to show you what is the result of the estimation of the free energy when we compute the probability distribution for the unital channel, which is basically the average over all these results. Well, actually, it's the free energy obtained from the average probability vector. This is the result. So you see that the agreement between the measured value and the theoretical value, the estimation. So this estimation is done by just saying, hey, I have a two-level system, then I have the partition function, I compute the free energy, and that's it. So this very good agreement, and we think the error, theoretical error, and it's more or less of the same order of the experimental error, because it comes from estimation of the temperature. So this is the end. I showed you how to build a quantum work meter. In what sense this is a quantum work meter, how it operates, and I presented the first experimental implementation of this sort of device, and the way we used it to test the Yersinsky identity, and to draw this kind of plots of the Yersinsky manifold. So there is some work in progress, because we are extending this to three dimension, because we have more levels that we can access, and we are also extending it to test Crookes' identity and so on, which is a bit harder. So the problem with the D equal 3 is how to do the entangling operation, because the previous entangling operation only involves the only levels, for example, the M equal 0 level does not interact with the magnetic grade. So if you have if you are using M equals 0, 1, and 2 in order to define your system, and you want to be completely universal, so to be able to sample the work probability distribution for arbitrary initial, final, and Hamiltonians and intermediate driving, you have to be able to make the three levels interact with the magnetic gradients, so that you will need to have two gradients and a rotation in between. So, which is not so easy, but I think it can be done with the current knowledge. Go beyond D equal 3 with this, it's not going to be possible. So that's it.
Thank you very much. Wonderful talk. So, other questions? Yeah.
Okay. Are there any questions similar to the one before? So that now the experiments were done with diagonal states, right? Sample states.
Say it again.
The experiments were only done with thermal states. Right?
The experiments were done with pure states.
Okay, so assume I'm starting in the plus state, and I'm applying a Hadamard gate.
Yeah.
Then the TPM scheme would obviously fail, because the two projective measurement scheme would give us zero work on average, which is not what we want. But we want, like, if we go from plus to zero, we want the difference between the two eigenstates.
So you're thinking that H and H tilde are the same?
For example, yes.
And you just do a Hadamard.
Just going from plus to zero, we don't want to have zero average work. but okay. What average work that is like 1/2 times the difference between the two megastates.
Okay.
But the TPM scheme would give us 0 work on average. But you say that in your case you would get the correct average work after a small error?
No. I am saying that you will get the same. So this machine, let me call it machine, samples the same probability distribution that the 2-time measurement.
Oh, so you also
so
get
it has been designed
okay.
in such a way. So we I showed the 2-time measurement protocol defines the probability distribution. The line of thought was, oh, this probability distribution is associated to a generalized quantum measurement, POVM. Then I can realize it by attaching an ancilla. How do I do it? This is the way to do it.
Okay,
but the probability distribution that you are sampling is the same as the 2-time measurement scheme.
Okay.
And, it's the same, provided that you start either with the thermal state for the system, or you do the strong interactions and the wave pack, the wave packets split, and you don't have interference.
Yeah.
So the I found the simulation of the unity channel great. I mean, you know, we know that the Dzerzhinsky equality holds, but it's also interesting. I was wondering, is there a way in the experiment simulate a non-unital channel, because
no.
We know then the Dzerzhinsky is violated, but we know it's violated in a very particular way.
Work in progress, yes.
So
there
so
is, because, for example, you can say, suppose that you, in between, so a way to do it, which we thought recently, involves, so you're driving the system between 1 and 2, and instead, so if you drive it perfectly between 1 and 2, you're just, it's unitary, but you can induce like a pipe pulse with the, that would take it to level 0 and back, no? So there will be part of the system that is not interacting with the unitary.
Yeah, that'll do it for you, yeah. Yeah,
yeah so you will have some probability of nothing happening because you come back to 0. If you were in 0, you are still in 0. And then you are have another probability of a unitary.
And is there any, maybe it's for, is there any hope of doing any feedback? Because there's very nice relations on fluctuation theory with feedback, so you make a measurement and then condition on the measurement, and then you have a non-unital channel, and the non-unitality is related to, you know, somehow some information theory.
We would have to do something.
Segawa and these guys in Kisaki.
It could be done, but we would have to do something before we take the image and sort of do something else, no? With this. I don't know how. I mean, these atoms are falling, no?
Yeah.
And the chamber is
sure.
So there's not that much time, but I don't know how to do this feedback either.
Because I mean I don't think
it could be done, because you know you can estimate where the clouds are and you can do something depending
on where they are, exactly.
Yeah.
Because that's been done classically, right? As far as I know, that these experiments, there's some classical experiments with populations,
I mean,
with feedback, but never with,
yeah,
you know.
And also you can somehow bring the clouds back closer, or you cannot undo the gravity, no? They will fall, the relative distance between them can change. So the, Ron and his group, so the way we got in touch with them, because we sat in the journal club, was the in our journal club, someone looked at this wonderful paper by Ron and his group, where he does this sequence of Stangerbergs experiments. So you first split in one basis, and then you rotate, and then you split again. It's a textbook. So this atom chip, it really illustrates textbook examples of sequences of standard experiments. And you can bring them together and make them overlap and see the interference.
Okay. So let us thank to all the speakers of today, and thank you very much. Only you will say a few concluding words.
Okay, so we don't have enough time. But so maybe I will give 1 hour lecture now. It would be nice. But I think I want to answer a question that somehow people asked. Who started it? You thank the organizer. But I would say, let's thank Hussein first
yes.
of all. And the reason is, that he, in a way, initiated. He contacted Ferdinand and me and said, okay, please organize a workshop on the subjects. Why is this? Because he's a curious person. He wants to know what's happening in this field. This is how I interpret it. He's a curious person. He brought us together here. So I'm really grateful for that. I enjoyed this conference very much. And what is my criterion for trying? If I learn something, then I enjoy it. So the question is, if you sit here and everything is kind of passive, like a passive state, then it's not. If we are in a non-passive state and we have at least one bit of information that we learned here, so I think this is, from my point of view, of success. So I would thank the people who participated and thank everybody that was here. And now what we're supposed to go to. Okay, maybe you give us instructions what we are supposed to
do. Right, I mean, I think we should also thank Ferdinand and Ronnie for bringing everyone together here. Mm-hmm.